here is our model of this ABAC task using a standard kind of three-layer neural network, which is just like the one that McCloskey and Cohen used. So we have a input here representing the A item, so like window in our example, and then that's paired with a particular output pattern, reason in this case, the B item, okay? And then over here, we also provide a kind of list context representation. And this ends up being critical. It's a feature of most models of human memory. Some kind of contextual patterns that we are constantly carrying around with us. They include things about the environment, but also things about the time, and this kind of notion of this overall flow or stream of consciousness that, you know, you can never step into the same stream twice. It's constantly evolving and changing. We're always in some new state. And so all of that kind of gets bundled together into this concept of context. Context is this thing that allows us to essentially identify the first list, AB, versus the second list. And so part of that context could be like a semantic encoding, first versus second, in addition to all those other things that could be going on. And so in our model, we just have this pattern of activity. And in fact, all of these are just simple random patterns of activity. So A and B are just random patterns of activity. And we're using our standard error-driven learning paradigm, where we have the minus phase here, act M, the network gets the A item and the list context, and it's supposed to produce on the output the B item, and in the plus phase, we give it the B item, okay? So we give it reason up here, and now it kind of memorizes that, right? Using error-driven learning through a hidden layer, of course, just to give it plenty of resources to be able to learn this problem. And then we go to the next item. So this is another A item, and bicycle and garbage up here, etc. And we just keep going through learning about these items in a standard kind of neural network way, error driven. Then what we're gonna do is, after the network learns perfectly the full list of AB items, it's gonna automatically switch over and start learning the AC items, which is the same set of A items again, but now a new set of associates and a new context. And also you'll notice as we kind of step through the context here, the pattern of activity that we have for the context representation is kind of like this temporally evolving stream-like thing. It's a lot the same, but a few bits change here and there. There's something in common for all the AB items. Here it goes. The red line is showing us the AB items. And as you can see, it gets, you know, through this error-driven learning in about 18 iterations through the training set or epochs. And that's the point at which it switches over to learning about the AC items. And this is where you see catastrophic interference, right? So whereas we were 100% correct, zero errors on AB, even before we even get off the floor, you know, we get any amount of correct, in other words, less than 100% errors, we're already at 90% errors on the AB item. So really catastrophic levels of interference. So this is a real phenomenon, easily replicated. Any neural network model will show you this, unless you do something special to prevent it. So now our job is to think about what's going on. Why is our model exhibiting this catastrophic level of interference? And again, when I teach this course interactively, this would be a moment when we have a nice discussion and people throw out different ideas about what's going on. Why are we getting this interference? So you can now spend a moment, pause the video, and see if you can come up with an answer. Okay. So hopefully you now have the answer, which I will just kind of confirm with you. So basically, the fundamental problem that gives rise to interference is that the same neurons and the same synapses are getting reused to learn about the AC items, And when we reuse them, having previously learned about the AB items, that knowledge about the AB, B associate that maps to this output representation of the B, is just getting overwritten. So the synaptic weights for this particular A item are basically the same synapses that are now kind of getting overwritten and used to learn that C association. That's what causes the interference. So to say it another way and to reiterate the point, interference is caused by reuse and overwriting essentially of synapses for new memories instead of using separate neurons and separate synapses to encode new information, that therefore preserving the prior knowledge. Knowledge is in the synapses. Everything we know about, everything we learn is in those synapses. And if we take those same synaptic weight values and overwrite them, you're just gonna erase the old memory. And it's just like you imagine in a computer, if you have memory encoding some information in some part of your RAM or on some part of your hard drive in a file system, if you overwrite that file, it's gone, right? It's that simple. So it's the same principle in the brain. There's nothing kind of dramatic about it in that sense. It's just overwriting of prior information. So you need to have new file names to encode the new information, new places in memory to encode the new information. And that is easier said than done in this model, but maybe you can also spend a moment here and I'll pause the video and think about how would you get this network to use different neurons and different synapses to encode the memories. Okay, so again, I'm just going to confirm what you already discovered in your thoughts there. By having fewer neurons active, you ensure that there's enough neurons to go around to encode the memories using different neurons. So one of the things we want to do is increase the amount of inhibition. So we can pump up that number from 1.8 to 2.2, for example. That by itself does have the beneficial effect of reducing the number of neurons that are active, but turns out that doesn't solve the problem completely. You can see maybe a little bit of an improvement. Really, you have to run this thing for multiple iterations, multiple runs, to really see reliably whether it's fixing the problem. Here it was a very bad run. So you can see that previous run was not very representative of the overall performance of the network. And so we need to do something, encourage the network to use different neurons to encode the different patterns. And one thing you might have thought of is like, well, what's different about the two different lists, the AB list versus the AC list, is really something to do with this context. So one thing we can do is increase the strength of the kind of pathway. We have a multiplier that we can apply to an entire neural pathway and kind of increase that strength. And that may help also encourage different neurons for different lists. Another thing we can do is make the randomness of the initial weight configuration higher. So that's the initial weight variance. One of the most important things we can do is change the number of hidden units in the network. And that we can do by clicking on this hidden layer. So now we can increase the size of the hidden layer. Make it 200 neurons, go big here, and rebuild. And now, when we look at what that does, we can actually increase the inhibition a bit further. And now we're starting to get to a place where there's plenty of room for different neurons to be active. And look at that, okay. So now, as we switch over here and start learning on the AC items, we can see that we still retain 40% accuracy, making about 60% errors on the AB items. Let's see what it looks like on a replication trial here. You always gotta see if your results are replicable. Not bad, not great. Okay, so overall, We can also look at the run plot, and it gives us a summary of the statistics. If you run across multiple iterations, it'll tell you what the final error is for AB and AC. Sometimes it fails to actually finish getting the AC correct, but overall you can see that we are getting kind of non-catastrophic interference. It's not as good as people, but it's getting a lot better than the original network. And so this really indicates that this principle that we can understand where interference comes from, again, it's very simple. It's overriding the existing knowledge, the previously learned knowledge about the AB association. And the way to prevent it is to use different neurons. And the way to get different neurons is to give plenty of room for the layer to have different alternative neurons to get activated. We just need to do these various things to encourage the network to actually use those different new neurons, like increasing the strength of the context and increasing the variability so that it just uses new neurons in the first place. These key lessons indicate that there are ways to fix this problem even within still using neural networks, but there might be some costs associated with that. You might think about that right here. What could be the downside to what we've done? Why would using different neurons to encode this information ever cause any kind of problem? We'll now return and think about how the hippocampus takes these basic ideas and kind of amplifies them to a great degree to avoid, to the greatest extent possible, interference while learning information rapidly.